It's never easy to be one of the pioneers. We will not reach the climate targets, actually, without CCS as an alternative. We don't have the luxury of saying no to technologies that will effectively reduce large-scale CO2 emissions.
Hi, I'm Bryony McKenzie, and welcome back to the Energy Podcast from Shell. And this bonus episode is where we're going to dive even deeper into carbon capture and storage, often referred to as CCS, after our last episode with Shell's VP for CCS, Bernard Kadelka. And I'm really pleased to be joined by Lise Winther from Yara, and Yara, customer of Shell at the Northern Lights project, which is a pioneering CCS project in Norway, where Shell, Equinor, Total Energies are developing the world's first commercial CO2 transport and storage as a service. For anyone who isn't familiar with CCS, it involves capturing CO2 before it's released into the atmosphere and storing it underground. And we're talking about that now because the first shipment is due this year, which we'll come on to later. But before we get started, to ensure that we're all on the same page, when I say Shell or we, I'm talking about Shell PLC and its subsidiaries in general. The companies in which Shell PLC directly and indirectly owns investments are separate legal entities. So Lise, give us a quick sketch of what Yara does and tell us a bit about your role.
Yes, thank you so much for the opportunity for us to be here today. Yara was established in 1905 with a mission to solve the European food scarcity by producing fertilizer. And today, Yara is a world-leading crop nutrition company and the world's largest trader of ammonia with a 25% market share. And we have a mission of responsibly feed the world and to protect the planet. And with this mission, we have reduced our emissions globally with more than 25% since 1990. And now we are working on the remaining challenge, the so-called hard-to-abate area, our ammonia production. And actually, that is very important because when you're producing fertilizer, you need to first produce ammonia. In that reduction program, we also are investing in both ammonia production from renewables and also ammonia production with carbon capture and storage. Going a bit into my role, I've been in Yara for 9 years. And before Yara, I've worked more than 25 years in the energy industry. And the last place I worked before Yara was in Shell, Norway, where I also worked within the CCS area.
So you've got a lot of experience in the kind of decarbonisation element of the process, and you've sort of explained how CCS is going to fit in with what Yara is trying to do and that decarbonisation journey. So talk to me about the Northern Lights process. How is that going to work for Yara? How are you involved in that?
I have been responsible for the development of the project we have then in the Netherlands, where we already have captured 800,000 tonnes of CO2. We are using CO2 both for urea production and also for food production and also to greenhouses. But we have some surplus captured CO2 that we are today venting. And then Northern Lights, they had some spare capacity, and that spare capacity fitted perfectly with our need for storage of the 800,000 ton. So it was a perfect match between the volumes that Northern Lights could offer to store for us and also the volumes that we could deliver to Northern Lights.
You've obviously got a wealth of experience with this technology. You understand it and it forms part of your kind of overall plan. How easy is the process of not only becoming part of the Northern Lights project, but just sequestering those emissions? Has it been an easy journey? I can't imagine it has been.
No, it's never easy to be one of the pioneers, I can say. But I think technology-wise, for us, we have probably a more easy journey than other emitters because we already had captured the CO2. So what we need to do is we need to liquefy that. And we already have processes for liquefaction since we are delivering CO2 to the food industry. So if, for instance, if you have a beer or if you have a Coke or anything, typically that CO2 comes from Yara, at least if you are in the Netherlands. So the technology for us is nothing new. Then Northern Lights will then come and pick up that liquefied CO2, pick up by boat, and then ship that CO2 to the west coast of Norway and then pipe it to the storage site, where it's then stored around 2,000 to 3,000 meters below the seabed.
In terms of challenges, I guess as you've covered, sort of from a technical point of view, it was something that you were already able to do. But I'm just thinking, do you think costs could be too high for some companies?
So I think that are three main elements that is part of the cost picture. First of all, they need to capture the CO2. And that, of course, has a capital cost and also an operational cost. And then, of course, it's the transport and the storage cost. In Europe, typically, then the benefit is that you will not then have to pay an EU ETS cost for those CO2 volumes. So they need to look into capital cost for the capturing and then the transport and storage and see whether if they go in above zero in profit. And I think that is maybe the main challenge, because the capital cost for capturing CO2 from other industries is very high. Yeah. And there it's important that the governments are supporting the investments that the emitters need to take to be able to go, because the industry will not take an investment if it's a loss.
Well, you raise an important point there. And actually, in the longer episode of CCS, when we spoke to Bernard Kadelka, he raised that issue of the value gap, which I think is what you're referring to. Because for people who don't know much about Northern Lights, there's been a big investment and a big kind of collaboration with the Norwegian government, really, to get it off the ground. That's right.
I would say that if it hadn't been for that support from the Norwegian government, this project would never exist. Northern Lights had taken an FID when we started talking. So then we knew that Northern Lights could deliver. So the scheduling issue and the chicken and egg issue was then sold, and the risk was then taken by the Norwegian government.
How important is that confidence that companies need, that longer term commitment, that the transportation is going to be available, that the storage is going to be available? I mean, it sounds like it's crucial.
That is extremely crucial, because it's not an investment for 5 years. It's an investment for maybe 15, 20, 30 years. You need to know that the transport and storage provider will be there in the future, and also that they have a system in place that is robust and flexible, that can cater for planned and unplanned maintenance, so that the emitters know that they will have some spare capacity in case of operational issues. And then governmental support to increase the infrastructure investment for CCS to get that infrastructure started and developed. It's extremely important, because then you can have more flexibility, and the emitters know that they can have potentially more than one supplier that can take offtake their CO2. As an emitter, it is difficult to only have one offtaker. If we want to reduce our CO2 emissions in Europe, it's important that the governments start to support CCS. And also, when supporting, it's important that they are a bit more technology neutral, not only focusing on renewable, but focusing more on the reduction in emissions. Because what's important is to reduce the emissions, not what kind of technology you're using.
What potential do you see for a wider market for CCS as a service to grow in Europe?
CCS has the best potential if you're talking about reduction of CO2. From my side, the main reason for that is that the CCS has the potential for large reductions in a very fast way compared to the alternatives. If you say it another way, that we will not reach the climate targets actually without CCS as an alternative. Today, we don't have the luxury of saying no to technologies that will effectively reduce large-scale CO2 emissions.
And just a final thought, Lisa. I mean, you've worked in this industry for a long period of time. Are you pleased by the change that you've seen in this area? Because it must have been quite a journey, I would imagine, from the beginning of days when no one really spoke about CCS, or it was deemed to be not proven. We're in a very different space now.
Yeah, definitely. I see also that the technology has developed. More and more companies also have introduced projects where they also have a firm offtaker. The change now, it comes more like a common sense that we need to use CCS as one of the main tools for meeting the targets, in especially in Europe. I see this is a big change over the last, let's say, 20 years. And also the technology now is much more mature. It started with coal power plants and gas power plants. And now it's more broader spectrum of the industry, and including the cement industry and so on. So we see CCS as a concept on a much broader landscape.
Thank you, Lisa, for your time today. It's been really interesting and really good to talk to you.
Thanks the same. It's been a pleasure to be here.
And if you want to know more about CCS and that longer interview that I've referred to is available on our channels. And you can also subscribe to the Energy Podcast on your favourite podcast platform. And of course, you can also watch us on YouTube. And remember that you can find Shell's cautionary note and references from today's episodes in the show notes. Thanks again. I'll see you next time.